Yo, it's your boy Young Mooly, now check this shit out, man. There's a story in Carlo Ancelotti's book, Quiet Leadership, a story from Adriano Galliani, the former AC Milan chief executive. I attended the last training session, Galliani said. Pippo Inzaghi, our center forward, was completely out of sync. He was barely able to control the ball. We had another strong center forward, Alberto Gilardino. As I was standing beside Ancelotti, on the side of the field, watching Inzaghi miss every single ball, I said to him, why don't we let Gilardino play? He looks to be in much better shape than Inzaghi. Carlo simply said, Inzaghi is a strange animal. Maybe tomorrow, it will be his night. That training session was before the 2007 Champions League final, where Super Pippo scored 2 goals. Pippo was a very particular player in his own terms, in the sense that he divided opinion very much. He celebrated every goal like he just scored a bicycle goal, or as if he dribbled 10 guys before hitting the top corner in a World Cup final, even though it was just a tap-in. When you look through his highlights, you barely find a screamer or even a special goal. Most of his goals are scrappy goals, where the ball bounces off his shin, off his knee, or his head, tap-ins, lucky goals, deflections, all that type of shit. But nevertheless, he was good at it and he scored many goals at the crucial times, and this is simply Super Pippo's story. Filippo Inzaghi started his career playing for his hometown club Piacenza as a teenager in 1991, but made only 2 league appearances before being loaned out to Albino Lecce in Serie C1, aka Italian 3rd Division. With them, Pippo scored an impressive 13 goals in 21 matches, which led back to Piacenza and then on to Parma in Serie A. Inzaghi made his Serie A debut when he transferred to Parma in 1995, but scored only twice in 15 league matches. And funny enough, one of these goals came in a game against one of his former clubs, Piacenza, where he literally cried after scoring that goal. The following season, he moved on to Atlanta, finishing as the top scorer in the Italian Serie A, with 24 goals in a season where he scored against every team in the division. He was awarded Serie A Young Player of the Year and served as a team captain in the last game of the season. From there he went to Schemkolin, where he went on to form a potent attacking partnership along with Alessandro Del Piero and Zinedine Zidane, a trio which lasted 4 seasons, under managers Marcello Lippi and then Carlo Ancelotti. In his first season with Juve, he won a Scudetto and he scored 6 goals to help Juventus to reach the Champions League final, although they were defeated 1-0 in the final by Real Madrid. On his 4th season with Juventus, his once excellent partnership with Del Piero had become less effective due to their lack of understanding, individualism and their beef on and off the pitch. Trezeguet was an emerging star from Juve and at that moment that was the end for Inzaghi at Juventus. He got sold to AC Milan in 2001 where he played for 11 years until his retirement. In the 4 years Inzaghi spent with Juventus, 3 of them he was the top scorer in the club, but he was underappreciated due to his style. In Milan, he developed an impressive partnership with Andriy Shevchenko, and he soon racked up an impressive trophy count with Rossoneri, under new manager Carlo Ancelotti. He won the 2002 and 2003 Champions League, in which Milan defeated his previous team Juventus in the final on penalties. He won the Scudetto in 2004, and again the Champions League in 2007. That final was the rematch of the 2005, where AC Milan were leading 3-0 at halftime, and Liverpool came back from behind famously to win that game. In the rematch final in 2007, he scored twice, and after the game he exclaimed that he dreamt as a young boy, scoring 2 goals in the final, and that these were the most important goals in his life. Just like with Andrea Pirlo in 2011, Milan decided not to renew the contracts of several veteran players at the end of the season. And Inzaghi was one of those, along with Gennaro Gattuso, Clarence Seedorf, Alessandro Nesta, and Gianluca Zambrotta. He played his final game for Milan against Novara in 13 May 2012 and marked his performance by scoring the winning goal, in typical Pippo fashion. On 24 July 2012, Inzaghi announced his retirement from professional football to start a coaching career. He was the first player to score 3 Champions League hat-tricks, a record since broken by Messi and Ronaldo, who both have 8 Champions League hat-tricks. When he was first called up to the national team, the other Italian players were surprised at his lack of technical accomplishment, but later on his teammates came to accept him because he scored so often. Johan Cruyff once said, look, actually can't play football at all, man. He's just always in the right position. In the past, due to his poor defensive work rate and a lack of technical skills, strength in the air, or long-range striking ability, he was initially accused of being a limited striker and a lucky player. Paolo Maldini said his colleagues would roll around laughing at his efforts in training. Vincenzo Montella added, even today I can't explain how he managed to score so many goals. He couldn't dribble, he couldn't shoot from outside the box. He had half the talent of players who had the half of the success. Now, Pippo Inzaghi, despite all these limitations, he won 2 UEFA Champions League titles, 3 Serie A titles. He is the 7th highest scorer in Italy with 313 goals scored in official matches. He is currently the 5th highest goal scorer in European club competitions with 70 goals, behind only Robert Lewandowski, Raul, Lionel Messi and Cristiano Ronaldo. He is also Milan's top international goal scorer in club's history with 43 goals. He also holds the most record for most hat-tricks in Serie A with 10. And those are just a few records Pippo Inzaghi holds. Jump Stamp, former Manchester United player who was Pippo's teammate at Milan, said, "At Milan we do a rondo every day, but Inzaghi didn't participate because he knew he'd be in the middle running around the ball." Now in football, for all the noise, all the experts around football, for all the discussions of tactics and all the systems and philosophies, ultimately the only things that really matter are the goals. Inzaghi was not only just as good at the only thing that really mattered, but the only thing that really mattered to him is the only thing that really matters. Yeah, feel me? Inzaghi was noted for his vision and ability to read the game, as well as his outstanding offensive movement of the ball, ability to play off the shoulders of the last defender, and to time his attacking runs to beat the offside trap. Ferguson once famously said, "That lad must have been born offside." Inzaghi had one thing you can't really teach a football player, and that's instinct. In theory, he was barely a footballer. In practice, he was one of the greats of his generation. If you watch a flamboyant genius do things with the ball that few others can, you admire them, but can't relate to them. Inzaghi, on the other hand, was incredibly relatable. The kind of sort of footballer you could tell to yourself in your head, "Yeah, I could do that," but that's never the case. Richard Hughes came through the ranks in Italy at roughly the same time as Inzaghi, and they were together since 16-17 in the academy. Richard Hughes said, "Sometimes the ball would bounce off his shin, bounce off his knee, and you'd think you were controlling him, but then he always found a way of coming away from these games with a hat-trick. Someone would miss a penalty, he'd be there for the rebound, a cross would come in, hit the post and bounce off him. His goals weren't pretty." He wasn't in love with the goals, once said Emiliano Mondonico, Inzaghi's coach in his early days with Atalanta. Goals were in love with him. And to be honest, man, so were we, man. Inzaghi was a player who learned to trust his guts from early in his career, a player who broke through the ceiling and the limit that was set for him, and he made sure he left his own mark on the game. He compensated for his lack of many aspects of the game by his team spirit, sacrifice and hard work. And in the end, he left the game with the respect of all his peers, man. And one of the most prolific Italian strikers in history. He is truly an example of making out the most of the little you have. But anyways, man, in the modern time, is there a footballer that reminds you of him? Let me know in the comment box. It's your boy Young Muli. It's late.